Hello, BookTube. It's Terry from Terry Talks Books, or Ms. Terry B. on YouTube. Most of you probably have figured that out by now. I am here today to talk about two books that I read recently. They were both buddy reads, and they were not my favorites. They were just not favorites. But I want to talk about them anyway, because I know some people are curious. In fact, I had one person actually ask about the first book I'm going to talk about. So excuse me if you see me looking around a bit. I am going to be consulting some notes because I'm doing this on the fly, and it's been a short while, but it's been a little bit since I finished reading both of these, and I've moved on to other things, so I may need some prompts to get through this and remember what it is I want to say to you. So the first book is that I'm going to talk about is How the Garcia Girls Lost Their Accents by Julia Alvarez. There's my copy. And I am not going to keep holding this up. I want you to see my flowers. See my beautiful tulips back there? I want you to be able to see those instead. Anyway, there's the book. And this was a buddy read with Alba from Siriella, the channel Siriella. A lot of you know Alba. And we both had wanted to read this book. We'd both had the book laying around for some time. And decided to read it together. So I am very glad I read the book, and I did enjoy it. It's just not what I was expecting. And you all have probably had that experience. So I didn't rate it over, when I do my Goodreads ratings, you've heard me say this before, I find these ratings rather arbitrary, but I do assigned stars. So I think I gave it a 3, which is fine. That is perfectly fine. If I rate something 3, I enjoyed it. But it didn't, I expected it to rate higher when I started out. So I've seen discussions about this, and it's kind of sad when we go into reading a book with certain expectations, and then it doesn't meet the expectations. It doesn't mean the book wasn't a good book. It means we expected something different. So that's pretty much what happened. I know that one of the people interested in my thoughts on this book is Adam from Roofbeam Reader. And I know I'm pretty sure he still keeps a blog. I see him on Instagram on occasion. So he specifically asked about this because he teaches at a university, and one of the books he has on the reading list is Julia Alvarez's other book, which is, let's see if I can pull that really quickly. They're not going to tell me on the back of the book. On the front of the book, In the Time of the Butterflies. So he includes that on his reading list, and so he was curious about this. Okay, here's my thoughts. This book was published in 1991, so it's not new. I don't know why, I mean, I've had it laying around for a while, but I didn't realize that it went back to 1991. Just, I probably knew that at one time, but had forgotten. So 1991, and as far as I can tell, the book was written in English, so there's no translating or translation to deal with here. So written in English, as far as I can tell. If that's not correct, let me know and point me somewhere, but where I can look that up. But at a quick look, I didn't see any attributions to a translator at all. So let's see. I'm going to talk probably more about the structure of the book because I found it interesting, and it is part of maybe what contributed to my not enjoying it as much. Maybe I missed something, I don't know. But there's not a lot content-wise to tell you. It is a series of interconnected stories. about four sisters and their experience immigrating from the Dominican Republic to the United States. So that's the basic premise of the book. And there's, you know, little things here and there, and I'll talk a little bit about some of the themes after I talk about the structure. So what I found interesting about the structure is that these groupings of stories, it presents as a novel, but if you think of it as a novel, which I was thinking of it that way, it doesn't help. If you think of it as a series of interconnected short stories or interconnected stories, I think that helps you, just helps you with the content a little bit more. Isn't that interesting that, you know, how we perceive a book as novel or short or stories, interconnected stories, would do that? But I found that to be true. So just, you know, something to think about maybe. But it goes backwards in time. So there's three sections. We have 1989 to 1972, 1970 to 1960, and then 1960 to 1956. So, and if you noticed, if you were paying attention, the section wasn't 1972 to 1989, it was 1989 to 1972. So the stories within those sections also go backwards. So it kind of messes with your head a little bit. And I thought, well, you know, I left myself open, you know, that the author has a reason for that. And she may very well have had a reason for that. But I never caught on. I thought, wow, this is going to like maybe make this whole thing give a punch at the end, you know, that we went backwards and, oh, now here we are. Oh, you know, some kind of big revelation or something. Nope. Didn't happen. Or either that or I missed it. And I don't think I'm that inattentive. So I could never figure out why the author, what her reason was for doing that. If it was for impact or she had some other reason for doing it that way, I'm not sure. But it does cover a fair over 30 years of time. So we have, you know, basically little girls. One of them, I think, was still a baby with no real memories of the homeland, the Dominican Republic. So, you know, they were very, very young. And then, you know, at the end where they're, you know, I would consider them still young adults, but I think we're up into our early 30s by then for some of the older sisters. They're very close in age too, so there wasn't a big spread. I think it was all, you know, within like a 4-year-ish time frame. So, you know, and like I said, you know, that threw me, that way of telling the story seemed to throw me, and I'm not sure what it was. Maybe I was supposed to be getting out of this. If the author thought it would help, you know, American readers to understand something better, I don't know. I'm just at a loss. So, that's the structure. That's the structure. Series of interconnected stories and everything goes backwards. Okay. It was still, you know, I wasn't super confused. You know, it was just, I didn't really understand why we were going backwards. And for me, I think maybe telling it the other direction would have helped me to read it and maybe get more out of it. I don't know. Hard to say. She didn't write it that way. So, who knows? So some of the themes, it is a story of obviously immigration. And I think that is one of the things that draws people in. It drew me in, you know, I was very interested in that. And I was also interested in it because it is an immigration from Dominican Republic, as opposed to Mexico or one of the Central American countries, or even Cuba or Puerto Rico. I'm a little bit more familiar with those places and immigration from those places, just I don't, you know, either I haven't realized that certain immigrants, you know, were from Dominican Republic, or, you know, I just haven't been exposed to that. I'm not sure. But anyway, it's a story of immigration, and they're all probably going to have certain things in common, no matter where the people are from. It's a story of generational differences, and tying in this idea of generational differences with immigration is pretty interesting, you know, because it's and I've had some experience with families who have immigrated, and you have, you know, the parents and then maybe the grandparents who they, you know, they spent their whole lives and have histories in the their country of origin. And then, you know, when they come here or wherever they're immigrating to, you know, this is a very big change, you know, language, just, you know, they have a history. And so I thought that was interesting. So not only just the regular generational differences, but now you have this whole, you know, combine that with the immigration issues. So, and not only would you maybe have older family members kind of, you know, looking at the way the youngins dress, you know, and their music and things like that, they're also comparing it to how things were in the home country. So just added complexity there. The other, let's see, what else? It's a story of two cultures. As I kind of just, you know, said here, you really do have, you know, some real cultural conflict going on within families, within the immigrant families. And something that I would call the immigrant as other. Who are you? You know, where is your home? Are you a Dominican, or are you an American? Or insert countries. So, you know, do you ever fully think of yourself as, you know, where you moved to, no matter how long you've lived there, going back and forth between countries? You know, this could cause some really interesting identity issues for people. So I just thought that was an interesting theme as well. So we have, you know, that's, to me, that was one of the most important questions, I think, that this book asked was, you know, where is home? Where do I belong? And unfortunately, these are the kinds of things, this and the history surrounding the Dominican Republic and why people were immigrating. Why were people immigrating from there? You know, there's this whole thing with a revolution and things I didn't know. And I was hoping to learn about that. And I didn't really get much of that. So again, you know, my expectations, I need to just go read some history apparently, but you know, I just expected a little bit more, to get a little bit more out of it in that aspect. So I just thought the whole thing was treated rather superficially, just at all levels. It wasn't unenjoyable. I enjoyed it, and there was some humor and, you know, just some great satire going on. And if you've had any relationships, you know, with people and families who've immigrated, you know, it makes it very interesting. Because you've seen some of it, you know, you've actually seen the interactions with these family members. And so I guess I just wanted more. I expected more, and it just seemed to kind of flow across the surface of some really important things. So the good part is that it's an enjoyable book. It wasn't hard to read at all. It didn't take me long to read it. And you might learn a little bit from it, you know, especially if that's not your main point. And, you know, so it's still worth, I think it's worth a read if this interests you, or if you're looking for something to read. But it just, it didn't really do what I wanted it to do. So that's why it got 3 stars in Goodreads. So if you've seen the Goodreads, you know, my star rating and wondered what the heck happened there, that's what happened. So that, I'm going to quit talking about that, and I'm going to go backwards in time, because I read the next book I'm going to talk about, I read before this one, and I'm really winging it here. But this was a, let me see if I've got the right notes. Okay, there we go. This is the one, the next book I'm going to talk about is Future Home of the Living God by Louise Erdrich. And this was a buddy read with Britta Bowler. And it was part of our over a year long author spotlight buddy read project. So we've been working on all the Erdrich, not every single Erdrich book, but all of, I'm excluding the children's books, the book she wrote with her at the time husband, and poetry, things like that. So we've been reading all of the books in publication order since January 2020. So we are currently reading the last book. So I will talk about that either later or elsewhere. But we're working on the last book now that Erdrich has published. So this was the second to last, and Future Home of the Living God. I'm going to put that down. And by the way, I will link in the description box the people I'm talking about and their channels and or Instagram pages, as it were. So so Future Home of the Living God. Okay, what do I want to say about this? This was another one that just didn't do it for me. Again, it wasn't a bad book, but it's clearly not one of my favorites, and I'm not sure which, I didn't go look before I came on here. I may have given it 2 or 2.5 stars, which is, for me, if I do that, it's dipping a bit below, there's just some real issues with it for me. And the enjoyment level of it didn't make up for those issues. So that's kind of, if I did give it that kind of rating, that's why that happened. So this book, Future Home of the Living God, is a dystopian. And I was kind of excited about that. And Erdrich has her way of writing, and she writes very much about her characters and their relationships and about her tribal people and, you know, issues surrounding them over a long period of time. So that's typical Erdrich. She's had a few books where she's wanted to step out of that and write a little bit more genre-like. There's still typical Erdrich involved in these, but she's clearly stepped out and said, oh, I want to try my hand at writing a mystery or a dystopian. Okay, so this one was dystopian. And I'm going to say right up front that if you've read The Handmaid's Tale, just stick with that. There's just too much in this book that was kind of addressing the same thing, but not as well. So I don't think she was trying to copy The Handmaid's Tale. I'm not saying that. And clearly she's telling her own story, and it's not The Handmaid's Tale, but there were just so many similarities. And Britta and I talked about this, and The Handmaid's Tale was done so much better with this more dystopian kind of a story. So, you know, I don't know if Erdrich was trying to keep it shorter. I'm not sure. I'm not sure what happened there. But it is a dystopian, and the basic premise is that we've got, suddenly everything is devolving. You know, there's, you know, what, a reappearance of, you know, saber-tooth tigers or something saber-toothy. you can tell that there's issues with women's pregnancies and birth of children. It seems to have happened very quickly, but we don't know why. And normally I would say, that's okay. I don't always have to know why. I don't have to know all these details for the book to carry, for that kind of thing to carry. But in this case, it would have helped, I think, to know something. I mean, there's absolutely no indication of what the heck, what is this? Why? It maybe didn't need to even be fully explained, but somehow something needed alluded to, and it just never happened. So, that was probably my biggest problem with it, is that everything just kind of left me hanging there. Let's see if I've got any. There was a creepiness to it. There were some, you know, as with typical Erdrich, and I love the typical Erdrich stuff that she included. So, you know, books can be rated, you know, like the story was this rating, but the characters were this rating, my enjoyment level was this rating. This book kind of fit that. Overall, I still only really gave it a 2.5, but the typical Erdrich stuff was still excellent. Her writing was still excellent. Her use of language was still excellent. So, anyway, and when she had these creepy things happen, she did it pretty well, I thought. So there were a couple of instances of real strangeness, and kind of some magical realism, kind of. There were just some interesting things that happened. Supernatural, magical realism. It was a strange blend of things. So anyway, let's see. There's some satire. That's typical Erdrich to throw that in. Let's see here. The disturbing thing about the book, I think, was the dread. And this I liked. It was the dread of something. So in that sense, not telling us, you know, do we have martial law? What is really going on here? So in that sense, not telling us some things worked to advantage for the atmosphere. But overall, it didn't really work. There wasn't enough of that to offset the things that I thought needed something. It just needed something. Here I am criticizing an amazing author. And I don't even have any really useful suggestions. So take this with a grain of salt. Let's see. But I did like that. This dread, you know, this not knowing actually had caused an atmosphere that was interesting. So it has an evolutionary or genetic theme going on here, but because none of that was addressed sufficiently as themes, it didn't really do anything. It didn't take me anywhere. It didn't give me too much to think about. You know, what's it tied to? What, you know, it just wasn't there. One of the positive things, let's see, I should have maybe broken this up into some negatives and positives, like, and categorized them as such, but it is what it is here. So women, the self-determination of women is a theme. I would have liked to see that developed out a little bit more, and that's typical Erdrich. So I guess I would have been surprised if it hadn't been there. So that was good. And let's see. I think that's really all I had to say about that. Yeah. So overall, that book just didn't do it for me. It's not going to be up on the higher rated Erdrichs over the last year and a half. So, and I will talk about that in a different video. And wrapping this up, oh, this is getting pretty long, so I am going to leave this here, and hopefully it's given you something, something to hang your hat on. So those are my wrap-ups for those two books, and I will talk to you all later, BookTube. Bye-bye.